So we decided that we will not cook food and ask people to come and eat. Because these are days when people are busy in one way or the other. So inviting people and everyone coming, if you cook in the morning, before evening, the food will be spoiled. So we decided that rather than giving cooked food, we will give them rice along with a piece of cloth, we decided. Like that we started. The system that we had evolved for the purpose was issue some tokens to selected families, poor families, and ask them to come. Invariably, the distribution is done by about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. So they will come with the token, we will receive the token, we will already have ready rice packets and pieces of cloth. With a little sweet, we start distributing to all of them. In our case, we were also doing a joint chorus Nama Sankirtana while the distribution was going on. At that time, I told Purushottama Swamiji, Swamiji, if this is something that we have to do, then why we restrict it to only to one family and its request? Why not we throw it open? Maybe other people also are interested. So the first year itself, we contributed a little money from our own ashrams, Narayan Ashram Tapovanam and Vyasa Tapovanam. And 150 families we were able to give the first year itself. At that time, the money they had given us had not accrued any interest at all. Because it is a noble dana, we decided that it should be done in a little organized manner. From 150, it started growing year after year. Every year, we prepare a letter explaining that this kind of an yearly Annavastra Dana Satram is going to take place. Now, this is the period in which it will be done. So far as Kerala is concerned, the month of July, we call it Ashadha or Karkidagam. That is said to be a very poor month for Keralites. It will be raining very heavily. And I say nature herself lays off the agricultural and farm workers. So they will be generally having a lot of difficulty to carry on. So we selected that month and started distributing it. Slowly and steadily, people started knowing about it. We will write a letter to the devotees and readers of our magazine. And getting the information, they started sending us some offerings as subscription or participation in the holy affair. Like that, we increased the number from 150 to 500, 500 to 1000, 1000 to 2000, 3000, like that. So this particular year, I think we are going to complete something like 27,500 poor families in Kerala. One more distribution is there in New Delhi, another in Jamshedpur. We are distributing it primarily in 3 districts in Kerala. In so many places, we will take packets of rice, cloth, etc. And an event will be held. So far as we are concerned, it is from about 45 distribution centers and maybe about 300 or more villages are involved. And all of them are looking to it with a lot of expectation and fondness. This is a little surprising to us. Initially, we were not able to give enough. So there will always be the token. People who have received the tokens, their share will be over and people would come and say, give us something. We used to distribute some cash for them. But in the course of 3 or 4 years, everything was regulated. Say from our ashram, Narayan Ashram Tapovanam, for the past few years, we have been distributing to something like 6,000 poor families. And they start lining up. The line is quite extensive. From 2 distribution centers, we started by 3 o'clock and finished by 6 o'clock. Up to now, no police, no authorities have come, either for help or for any other purpose. We have been managing it with our own volunteers and devotees. It has become so systematic that people are quite disciplined and they are very happy about it. Why did I say all that? Only because of this particular reference. Dhanam cha dharmai kaphalam yato vai jnanam savijnanam anuprashanti griheshu yunjanti kalehvarasya mrityum napashyanti durantavīryam. My dear souls, are you listening to me? Understand very clearly, for whatever wealth, resources, money or otherwise that you have, every one of you has to be grateful to the society at large. If an industrialist has got enough of wealth, he has got it from the society. His products are bought by them, availed of by them, and they pay for it. The poor man pays, the resourceful man pays, the half-resourceful person also pays. So we have an indebtedness about the whole thing. So the dharma is very important. When you have wealth and you are not a moralist, you are not an ethical person, understand that you are digging your own grave. Money or wealth is always to be employed for gaining dharma, dharma, dharma. And what is dharma? Dharma is that force or that power or that acquisition which will be able to sustain your life in good times as well as bad times, in prosperity and adversity. Dharma is the only source which is going to strengthen your mind, support your mind, enlighten your intelligence, give sufficient strength and stability to your inner personality. The discussion continues. These are all meant for householders. Yadghrana bhaksho vihitas surayah tathapasho ralabhanam nahimsa evam vyavayah prajayanaratya imam vishuddham navidusvadharmam. Yadghrana bhaksho vihitas surayah tathapasho ralabhanam nahimsa evam vyavayah prajayanaratya imam vishuddham navidusvadharmam. The last line says, this is actually the dharma prescribed for householders. And this is such a pure and a noble one. Alas, nobody comes to know of it. Everyone is mishandling, misdoing whatever they should rightly use. Now, our Vedas have a great and undeniable place in our culture and civilization. Our Vedas are ageless, anadi, they are said to be. In the Vedas, the first section, the first half, consists of hymns and rituals and ceremonies. These ceremonies are very protracted. It starts from Agnihotra, something to be performed by the householder in his own house. But it extends to bigger and greater dimensions. And ultimately you have something like great yagas and yajnas. And in the yaga and yajna, it is found that there is something called killing of an animal. An animal is killed. You know how the animal used to be killed? This is also something interesting. The animal was not killed using any weapon. They used to close the nose as well as the mouth. And the animal was stifled to death. And after death, a particular portion from inside the stomach that was being taken, offered in the form of sacrifice, and it was used as a prasada. Our yagas had this kind of an animal slaughter as an important part of it. But a question arises. The yagas by themselves are very, very sublime. They are supposed to be very sanctifying, sacred, sacrosanct. In such a holy sacrifice, can we think of killing an animal? But nevertheless, it used to be a part. So the question was always there, active. Is it right to kill an animal in the name of a Vedic sacrifice? And there used to be two opinions about it. So Srimad Bhagavata discusses it. And it gives you clearly a direction and a definition for whatever the Vedas have prescribed. Yadghrana bhaksho vihitas suraya tathapasho ralabhanam nahimsa. In the sacrifice, liquor, intoxicating liquor is used for some sacrifices. Flesh is also used for some sacrifices, meat. So here he says, yat ghrana bhaksho vihidasuraya. In the name of sacrifice, all that you are required to do is smell the liquor. Never drink it. Grana bhaksha. You know, whenever we have our food, what is meant by having the food or eating the food? We are taking the food in, normally through the mouth. But you can smell something. Through the nose, the smell also gets inside. The air also gets inside. So with the eyes we see, with the nose we smell, with the mouth we eat. Now all these are entry into our system. So here, Srimad Bhagavata says, Ghrana Bhakshaha. The type of food or taking that food should be through the nose. So just smell the sura, the liquor. Tatha pashoh alabhanam nahimsa. Never bleed the animal to death or choke the animal to death. Maximum you can pat and embrace the animal, that's all. The word alabhana has got more than one meaning. In the 7th skanda, Prahlada clearly says what? Adhokshajalambham ihashubhatmanaha sharirinas samsrati chakrashadhanam. The embrace of the invisible Lord. What does it mean? When your mind, heart and intelligence are embraced by your own invisible soul. God is actually invisible. And invisibility clearly makes him present within our body. Whatever is outside our body, they are all perceptible to the senses. To be imperceptible means to be inside the body. So the invisible Lord, his embrace for all impure people. Sharirinaha samsrati chakra sadhanam. It brings an end for this metempsychosis, this kind of a samsaric revolution in the world. It brings a stop to it. Now that alambhana is mentioned here. Tatha pashor alabhanam nahimsa. It is never intended that in such a holy sacrifice an animal will be killed, either stifled or maybe made to bleed to die. It is not expected. Evam vyavayah prajaya naritya. In the same manner, when people get married, they are given the freedom to indulge in sexual interactions. But that is only with a view to have a child, not for sport or romance. Evam vyavayah prajaya naritya. Prajaya means for the sake of having a child. Naritya, not for the sake of simple sexual romance. Imam vishuddham navidusvadharmam. This is the pure dharma that is ordained for the householders. But unfortunately, people are not able to know it. Therefore, even celebrated people, including Brahmins, are killing animals. In the north, you will find there are many temples where goats and other animals or birds are sacrificed even today. I am never able to understand this. In the name of God, in the name of devotion, why should you kill an animal? If you want to kill and eat, you do it from a slaughterhouse, through a slaughterhouse. Why should you invoke God for the purpose? So many people are going on worshipping. All of them are not interested in seeing the blood or in sacrificing. A public place of worship will have to be kept in a sanctifying manner. It has got a lot of sacredness. Sublime influences should enter into our system. There, if you make it a place for slaughter, what great contradiction is there? I think it is high time that people start thinking seriously about it. Here is Srimad Bhagavatam, voicing the very purpose of the Vedas. You may kill, that's a different matter. But you cannot kill in the name of God, saying that Vedas have ordained it. Vedas have ordained it. Certainly not. The whole event is discussed in the form of a story. Harishchandra did not have a son for a very, very long time. You know, for married couples, always the birth of a child is a must. If they are not able to have a child, they will feel a great sense of loss. However much they may argue, they will not be able to fill the gap at all. So people start doing many things, invoking several deities in order to have a child. Harishchandra started propitiating Varuna, and Varuna ultimately appeared and said, "You will have a son." So Rohita was born. But before blessing him with a son, Varuna had extracted a promise. So what is that promise? When a child is born, are you following me? See, this is a wonderful story. You have to listen to it very carefully. I hope I will be able to narrate it for you well. I shall try. Varuna had extracted a promise from Harishchandra. Okay, I will bless you with a son. But when the son is born, you should sacrifice him for me. I am wondering, my dear viewers, what will you say if such a blessing is given to you? You don't have a child and you propitiate the Lord. The Lord appears before you and then he says, okay, I will gift you with a son. Normally you are not fated to have a son, but I will give you a son. In any way, if a son were born, normally you would not be having it, that is why, but I give you. But you should make a sacrifice of that son, performing a sacrifice for me. Will you agree or not? You must answer me. Some of you should call me and tell me or write to me what is going to be your reaction to this. Harishchandra said, okay. So much was the desire, uncontrollable desire and possessiveness in the mind of Harishchandra that he said, okay, give me a son and I will sacrifice him for you. Even then, I will have the joy of being a parent and having a son. At least for a few days, that baby will be with me. So he agreed. Harishchandra agreed. How blinding and forceful is a desire of the mind and heart. Can you imagine? Agreeing to have a child, at the same time giving a promise that I will kill the child and perform a sacrifice for you. The son was born. A few days passed. Varuna came. And he said, you told me that you will give me the son. So give me the son. He said, not now. The child is too young. So how can I hand over that child? You cannot call him as a child. He is only days, weeks and months old. So at least let the teeth sprout in his mouth. At that time I shall give you. Varuna went back. He came again. The teeth had already sprouted. Then he said, no. Let him begin to speak well. After some time, Varuna came again. Then he said, let all the milk teeth fall and the real teeth sprout. In this way, he started giving excuses one after the other. Meanwhile, Rohita was growing up. He came to know that my father is going to sacrifice me for Varuna. Any son coming to know of it, what will he do? So he decided that this is not going to be a plight which I shall accept. So he decided to escape from there. Once he knew that this is a promise that the father had made for Varuna, he decided that I will go away. So the son escaped. He went to the forest and disappeared there. When the son was away and the father was left with no option, he was sorry that the son had left, but he had no means to trace him at all. Those were days when we did not have police and Google, etc. to picture the whole of the earth. That was not there. So the father was helpless. So coming to know that the father would sacrifice him, the son disappeared. Varuna did not leave. He was relentless. What did he do? He caused Mahodara, ascites to the father. Mahodara is a very deadly disease. These days, I don't know whether it has any cure. In ancient times, it was considered to be a Mahavyadhi. So that was caused. Now, when he came to know, because of me, the father is affected by ascites and it's an incurable disease, the son wanted to come back to the father. When son was coming back, Indra intercepted. Are you following me? Indra intercepted and said, go on a pilgrimage, don't return to the father. If you go back, you will be sacrificed. The only way and salvation will be you go on a pilgrimage. So it became an issue between Varuna and Indra. This Indra is a troublemaker in all places. So at that particular point, he intercepted Rohita and said that you go on a pilgrimage. After finishing a pilgrimage, when he came back, he said, go again on another pilgrimage, a longer one. In that way, he was going on. Varuna was coming again and again. So what should be done? Harishchandra decided to have another son, an adopted son-like person, to sacrifice. After all, he has to fulfill his promise. His son is missing and he is not coming back. So what is the point in having a son and not doing the sacrifice? Without the sacrifice itself, the son is missing now. I don't have the benefit of a son. So let me at least fulfill the promise I have given. So what did Harishchandra do? He bought Shunasheba for a price from his father Ajigartha, who was suffering from grinding poverty. So there was a Brahmana who had more than one son. He was suffering from acute poverty, that was the distress. To get relieved of the distress, he sold his son to Harishchandra. That Shunasheba was bought like that, and then he prepared a sacrifice to be performed for the sake of Varuna. But nobody came forward to kill this boy, Shunasheba. Who will kill? After all, it is killing. We have heard animal sacrifice. Here it is not a sacrifice of animal. It is sacrifice of a human being, a child. So nobody was ready. I don't know whether I should tell you this story. See, Harishchandra decided, somehow I must fulfill that promise. See, religion is so strong in our mind that the promise anybody makes religiously, it has to be fulfilled. And in fulfilling it, even the members of the family, they stand away. All ties of the heart are broken. It is such a strong force in one's man. Even now, sometimes we hear in the north some sacrifice is made by the father or by the mother, etc. We are hearing. So Harishchandra, giving more money to the father, got the father, made him agree to kill the son for the sacrifice. The son started crying. When he started crying, Vishwamitra intercepted and said, he instructed him on a Varuna mantra. Here is a mantra to invoke Varuna. So you are crying already in a distress. So take this mantra and go on chanting it. Shunasheba, in his utter distress, he was going to die, he was going to be killed. He started reciting it with all steadfastness and complete dedication from his heart. So Varuna himself appeared on the scene. My dear viewers, are you listening to it seriously? Here is a sacrifice being made for Varuna by Harishchandra. He was not able to offer his son, so he bought a son. And that son was not killed by anybody. So the father himself was induced by giving more money to him, and he came to kill him. The son started resenting and crying. Suddenly from the assembly, it was a great sacrifice. All the sages and ascetics had assembled. Vishwamitra was there. Vasishtha was there. Jamadagni Maharshi was there. So it was not an unimportant scene. It was a great and unique, unparalleled scene where all the sages, all the Maharshis that we know of were present. So Vishwamitra gave him this mantra, and chanting the mantra, Varuna himself appeared. And he declared, no himsa, no sacrifice killing is necessary. This is what Varuna said. Why is this story offered? Only to make you understand that in the name of a divine sacrifice, no himsa, no killing of any kind is either necessary or permitted. Never use slaughter as a means for propitiating a divine source. Not at all necessary, absolutely uncalled for, very sinful. Let us be very clear. Srimad Bhagavata makes it very, very clear. It is the latest scriptural composition that we have before us.